Welcome to the first episode of our book talk series, Spatial Practice in Chinese Art History and Visual Studies, organized by the Department of Chinese Culture of the Hong Kong Polytechnic University. I am an organizer of this book talk series and also a host for today's event. My name is Kathy Mack, an assistant professor of art history at the Department of Chinese Culture. Joining me organizing this talk series and also hosting this event today is my colleague, Dr. Pan Lu, associate professor specializing in cultural studies, also from the Chinese Culture Department. So as a quick background, Lu and I have the idea of organizing this book talk series for two major reasons. First, both of us are interested in the articulation of space as opposed to time in all kinds of visual production. So in this talk series, we define spatial practices as research methods or approaches that researchers use to engage with any notion of physical or abstract spaces, oftentimes explore through concepts such as place, site, location, landscape, monument, cartography, geography, etc. Second, both of us want to make use of technology of video conferencing to create a domain where specialists or friends interested in art history or visual studies to get together to discuss or simply to learn about some of the major publications in the field. We wanted to promote the culture of reading, especially for books, because books explore and spread knowledge so differently compared to articles. Today, we are very honored to have Dr. Stephen Whiteman, Senior Lecturer of Asian Art at the Courtauld Institute of Art, the University of London. Dr. Whiteman will share with us his new book titled, Where Dragon Veins Meet, the Kangxi Emperor and His Estate at Rehe, published by the University of Washington Press in 2020. And his book has just recently translated into a Chinese version published in Beijing this year. So our talk today will be divided into three major parts. First, the speaker will deliver to us a lecture for about 40 to 45 minutes. And after that, Lu and I will have a conversation with the speaker for about 15 minutes, followed by a Q&A with the audience. So hi, Stephen. We are very excited to have you as the first speaker in this series. So maybe I can begin by asking you a question in order to help the audience to get into your work a little bit, okay? So sure. Could you please tell us how you became interested in Bishu, Shanzhuang, which is the key location explored in your book? And also, you were trained as an art historian at Stanford. So what motivated your interest in landscape studies and apply some of the techniques, methods from that field into your research of art surrounding this location?
Well, thank you so much for the introduction and for the question, but most of all for inviting me. It's really just such a pleasure to be here. And I'm really excited by the idea that your series both captures and reflects some changes in how Chinese landscape studies are being worked on. You know, I think that it's important for us to reflect on the ways that our generation and recent work is changing and asking new questions compared to what our teachers might have been asking. So it's really, which is just as it should be. And so it's really exciting to be here. The answer to the first question is, gosh, I honestly don't entirely remember how I first became interested in Bishu Shanzhuang. At the time at Stanford, there were, quite by coincidence, I went to Stanford first thinking that I was going to work on post-Mao art. And I think that I have no idea why I thought that, why I was going to do that, but that's what I thought. And then I got interested in landscape, which is a big interest of my supervisor, Richard Vinograd. I mean, Rich, though his most famous book is on portraiture, he's really a landscape person at heart, I think. But I had then before that thought that I was going to work on sacred mountains before I got to Bishu Shanzhuang. But quite by chance at the time, though Qing art has become a growing and bigger field, at the time, very few people worked on it. And it happened to be that there was a real collection of people at Stanford at that moment who were all working on the Qing court. And so I became interested in Bishu Shanzhuang because I think we were doing a seminar on Courtauld, and I just stuck with it. I've also been working on gardens for a long time. Before I went to graduate school, I was the curator of a Chinese garden. So I think it's been a long time. And my undergraduate thesis was on the Chu Bifu and representations of the Red Cliffs. And so I think that I've just been interested in landscape for a long time. The answer to the second question, for better or worse, is essentially my talk. So, you know, really briefly, what I'm going to talk about today is not to, you know, read a chapter of my book or survey the contents of the book, but is to talk about one of the ways I went about trying to think about spatial issues, particularly around the use of GIS and computational technology and digital art history, but also just to sort of foreground it, really the intersections or the connections between digital art history, for me at least in my practice, between digital art history and what we might call analog art history, how I adapted the work that I was trained in painting history and in visual culture, and how I sort of started to think about sites as places to work on, and then how I began to adopt digital tools in response to challenges that I was facing. And the reason I have been working on this paper for a while is in part because a question I often get asked is, well, how do you know when you have a question that would benefit from the digital? How do you know when you want a digital project and when you don't? And that seems like a really valuable issue to address. So anyway, I hope that answers the questions. It turns out that the very first time I ever went to China when I was 16, I went to Bishu Shanzhuang, and I had completely forgotten that fact when I went to do my field work. And I showed up and I thought, oh my gosh, I've been here before. I'd totally forgotten. And so maybe it was always fated to be that I would, right, that I would work, that I'd spend my 30s in Chengde. Anyway.
That's a lovely story. So without further ado, let me hand the time to you. We are very looking forward to your presentation now.
Great. So let's start. So just to sort of highlight, I've been talking through a sort of series of different pieces of my work and how I approached it. And we can return to a lot of the slides if you'd like to. But one of the things I want to stress is that just to sort of foreground it, is that I am showing in this talk a lot of working drawings or working maps and visualizations. I mean, the visualization that you see right now on the screen is one from my book. But for those of you who may have had a look at the book already, the maps that are in it are the result not only of a lot of research and a lot of building, but then also a close collaboration with a cartographer, a professional cartographer named Daniel Huffman. And so I wanted to show you how I did some of this myself. The other thing I want to stress is that some of it I really did do myself, but a lot of it I didn't do alone at all. I worked really closely with someone, a doctoral student at the University of Sydney, where I was teaching at the time, named Kirilli White, who's an archaeologist. And Kirilli and I worked together to build the working GIS database, the Geographic Information Systems database that I ultimately built the maps out of. And so while the research is my own, the technology was something that I really worked with very closely with a partner who was important, not only from a technological point of view, I just am not that good on GIS, but also from an intellectual point of view. A lot of how we made decisions we came to together, and that part is very important for the work. And I want to acknowledge that up front, not only because it's important to acknowledge one's collaborators, but also to stress that I think that art history is changing. And that it's becoming more, not only more multidisciplinary, but also more collaborative. And that personally, I think that's much to the good. Okay, let's see if we can cause my slides to move forward. The study of pre-modern architecture and built environments, particularly those involving extensive design landscapes, presents a variety of challenges for the art and architectural historian. Fragmentary source pools and unconventional sources, incomplete architectural remains, fundamentally altered through restoration or encroached upon by modern pressures, and the problems of reconstructing historical stratigraphy, often obscured not only architecturally through intentional changes, destruction, or decay, but also conceptually as new occupants seek to simultaneously build upon and ally the presences of their predecessors. Pre-modern Chinese landscapes offer particularly productive cases for considering these challenges. Often popularly understood as embodying a particular historic moment, the primary sites extant today reflect only the most recent of their repeated alterations over time. Neither the original states of the gardens nor their evolving forms tend to be well documented. There is no surviving evidence of pre-modern practices comparable to the architectural drawings or models prior to the 19th century. And those images and textual records that do survive are often rhetorically laden, such that their utility as evidence has heretofore not been well understood. These concerns are at one level formal, in that they address first and foremost questions related to the building, complex, or garden itself, design, construction, material, and the like. Implicated too, however, is the experience of space, as changes to structures or landscape naturally affect physical and psychological interaction with the environment. While we know a great deal about the experience of Chinese landscapes from a literary perspective, our ability to relate those experiences to specific areas, specific spaces remains relatively limited. When triangulated against time, in effect setting a series of static spatial configurations into motion through a juxtaposition of architectural and lived experience, these concerns have the potential to drive the reconstruction of historical landscapes in forms that permit their mobilization as evidence in understanding broader historical questions. This talk, which represents a methodological reflection on my recently published book, so kindly introduced a moment ago by Kathy, explores challenges and opportunities encountered in the use of geographic information systems, or GIS, in reconstructing the historical landscapes of the largest 18th century Qing Imperial Park Palace, Bishu Shanzhuang, or the mountain estate to escape the heat. Rooted in other strands of spatial thinking about humanistic subjects, the methods and outcomes described here seek to put the disparate sources of architectural, landscape, pictorial, and textual archives related to the site in harmony and tension with one another, to visualize multiple overlapping iterations of the mountain estate in physical and imaginative forms. In 1702, the second emperor of the Qing, the Kangxi Emperor, ordered the construction of a large summer park palace in an Inner Mongolian region known as Rehe, now modern Chengde, Hebei province. Over the course of the following decade, imperial builders constructed a complex design landscape incorporating several hundred individual structures, including palaces, temples, and pavilions for taking in the scenery, an elaborate system of lakes and waterways, a network of roads and paths for roaming, and a crenellated wall to encompass the whole. During the last decade and a half of his reign, the Imperial Park Palace functioned as the Kangxi Emperor's de facto second seasonal capital. From the completion of an initial architectural installation in 1708 until his death in 1722, the emperor spent as much as 6 months of the year in Rehe, conducting the business of state and enjoying the cooler breezes of the Inner Mongolian mountains. Following the Kangxi Emperor's death, the site went unused for more than a decade, as Kangxi's son, the Yongzheng Emperor, never visited Rehe while on the throne. This period of relative neglect, which may have included at least one fire, led to a certain level of decay within the mountain estate, such that Kangxi's grandson, the Qianlong Emperor, undertook an initial six-year period of restoration and expansion before resuming an annual schedule of visitation in 1741. The mountain estate played as important a role in Qianlong's constellation of imperial spaces as it had in Kangxi's. As the circumstances of imperial rule changed over the course of the 18th century, however, so too did the built environment that supported it. Qianlong built numerous new complexes within the garden walls, increasing the number of individual structures from around 200 to nearly 1,000, while establishing nine large Buddhist monasteries outside the garden walls to complement the two already constructed by Kangxi. And this map you can see shows various phases outlined in the Qi. Here are the Kangxi temples, the rest are all Qinlong. And these spaces, as you probably have already deduced, have been consolidated. So each of these colored blobs actually includes lots of buildings, but the scale of this map is too small to allow us to depict the individual structures. Yet the steady progress of restoration, alteration, and new construction at the mountain estate that occurred under Qinlong's rule, despite the steady progress of restoration, alteration, and new construction of the mountain estate that occurred under Qinlong's rule, scholars of Chengde have tended to study the site only in its late 18th century form, which is to say its form of greatest expansion and development in the late Qinlong period. The course of development of the site is taken to be one following a single overarching design, rather than the distinctive activities of two separate rulers themselves, not monolithic over the course of their long reigns, separated by a period of inactivity and decay, the Yongzheng period. The same may be said of the substantial changes the site has undergone in centuries since Qinlong's death. Its continued use by the court through the end of the Second Opium War in 1860, the question of its maintenance until the close of the dynasty in 1912, the substantial decay that followed during the so-called warlord period and Japanese occupation of Manchuria, its use during the Mao era, and the process of its restoration and ultimate designation as a UNESCO World Heritage Site and National Park in recent decades. These have all largely been obscured by its current state of reconstruction and public use. Reflective of changing political, social, and environmental conditions, as these many transformations are, the persistent emphasis on a single moment in the Park Palace's history, itself questionably defined and understood, has not only obscured the history of the site, but also the site's capacity to speak to the changing world of which it was and is a part. Given the centrality of the site to the lives and reigns of its primary occupants, as well as its central role in major events of the 19th and 20th centuries, recovering a sense of architectural stratigraphy and changing usage over time is not only essential to an architectural history of the site, it allows the landscape to function as a sort of spatial archive, which may in turn be mobilized as evidence in a more nuanced understanding of changes to rule and rulership over the course of the Qing. The significant focus on the Qinlong era that describes study of the mountain estate is not unique to the site, but to some degree characterizes much of the scholarship of the so-called High Qing period, or long 18th century. This is substantially a function of sources. The extant archival, textual, artistic, and material records of the Qinlong era dwarf those of any other pre-19th century reign. By contrast, the surviving archival record of the Kangxi court is quite small, leading scholars to rely substantially on sources written or compiled under Kangxi's successors for information about his rule. Moreover, the surviving sources that speak to the earliest phases of development in Rehe under Kangxi are often unconventional and diffuse in terms of form or iteration of the landscape, architectural, pictorial, conceptual, to which they speak. They include a court-published book, The Imperial Poems on the Mountain Estate to Escape the Heat, which ironically, in this particular image, I'm actually showing a Qinlong edition of, just underlining how pervasive Qinlong's presence is. This book combines images of 36 scenic spots within the garden and the emperor's own prose and poetic descriptions of them. A large hang scroll on the right by the court painter Lung Mei, perhaps datable to shortly after completion of the first phase of construction, circa 1709. A brief first-hand description of a senior official, Zhang Yushu, who traveled to Rehe as part of the emperor's retinue in 1708. A total of perhaps 20 or so memorials and edicts, most of which discuss the imperial poems rather than the site itself. And surviving portions of the daily court diaries, known as the Qijuzhu, or the diaries of activity and repose, which, while not speaking directly to the site per se, describe some of the emperor's activities while in residence there. The models and plans Kangxi ordered prepared in 1702, the substantial written record that undoubtedly accompanied the practical aspects of the mountain estate's construction, or even detailed accounts of its art historical manifestations, none of these are known to survive. Given this limited material, it is perhaps no wonder that historians have often resorted to sources that were produced in later periods, and thus are by definition secondary sources when attempting to study Kangxi directly. Things like the veritable records or Qing Shulu, which would have been, of course, compiled under Yongzheng, Kangxi's successor. Gazetteers, such as the imperially sponsored gazetteer of Rehe or the Qingding Rehezhi, which is a late Qianlong product, and similar. This series of historical and historiographic concerns presents three central issues. First, how may a sense of stratigraphy be restored to a site that has been repeatedly reworked, often with the intention of obscuring past formations in the service of present concerns? What forms might this reconstruction take, both in terms of a legible scholarly output, plans, reconstruction drawings, models, etc., and, just as important, functional research tools that facilitate productive engagement with the underlying data? Second, how can unconventional, incommensurate source materials be made to interact in a productive manner? One that not only addresses one's original research questions, but also helps generate new and unanticipated lines of inquiry. And finally, once restored, what do the different strata of the landscape suggest about differences in the social and political context of their creation? GIS provides a powerful tool for addressing these questions, as it offers a common denominator with which to bring sources into dialogue with one another, geospatial information. Moreover, the resulting visualizations can constitute both what we think of as conventional GIS queries, maps that show certain things, and what Luke Bergman and Nick Lally term geographical imagination systems, what they describe as blurry cartographies that seek to incorporate partial, situated, and subjective data, such as those with which the historian so often works. For Bishu Shanzhuang under the Kangxi Emperor, the source data may be divided into three broad categories outlined here. First, primary sources, which are those textual and visual sources that date from the Kangxi period itself, including more or less subjective records of firsthand experience. Second, secondary primary sources, which include similar materials that are the result of post-Kangxi archival, pictorial, poetic, and memorializing efforts. And third, the site itself, which is in some respects the most complex source to parse. Unlike a datable text or image, the landscape is decidedly contemporary, but with definite, if ambiguous, connections to earlier configurations and events. Data culled through archival research and coding of poems, images, and other materials was placed in a table organized by the smallest individual architectural unit, the single hall or building. The database records basic information such as date of construction, destruction, and or restoration to the extent that this could be determined, structural and functional typology, whether or not the structure appears in certain key texts or images, e.g., is it in the Lung Mei painting or is it not? Does it appear in one of the 36 view sprints or does it not? And relations to other structures by factors of scale, specifically grouping halls into compounds and compounds into clusters of sites made legible by geography, such as being located within a particular valley, or chronology, as in constructed in the same defined time span, a single year or a series of years. Each entry was then assigned a geolocation based on a published topographic plan of the site executed circa 1980. The plan was georectified in order to provide coordinate data, a process that revealed inaccuracies in building locations that were corrected using a combination of satellite imagery, on-ground GPS surveying, and reasoned inference. And just to clarify, you saw this map a second ago, but you'll notice it's a little bit wonky now. It's a little bit tweaked. And you'll notice particularly that it's a little bit tweaked in the upper left and on the left-hand side of the map. That's because this plan was originally surveyed, but the surveying is most accurate, as you might imagine, in the center where it's flat and open. And as you get into these sort of very steep mountains, it starts to get actually wildly inaccurate. And so what we've done is we've done something called georectifying, which is basically, maybe you know what it is to pin the map to the earth and therefore stretch it and show you where it's not quite accurate. And the result is then this map, which is just a scan of something, is now invested with geographic data. And so in ArcGIS, this map now actually can show you where you are on the Earth, which is a useful thing. The topography and hydrography from the map, which is say the landforms and the water, which were quite accurate at the center of the park, as I just said, but became increasingly problematic as one moved into the mountains and towards the periphery of the grounds, were ultimately discarded in favor of more contemporary data, namely a 10-meter digital elevation model, the best available as open source, and derived hydrology flow model. A digital elevation model is a three-dimensional, a sort of two-and-a-half-dimensional, but let's say three-dimensional model of the Earth's topography that is derived from satellite or plane data or other types of scanning. And 10 meters means that each pixel of that model is equivalent to 10 meters on a side. And so it's 10 meters by 10 meters square. That is not terrible. I mean, you definitely can get much rougher data, but to get much finer data, and in theory, you know, I mean, sitting here in London, I imagine there is an open source DEM of London that is somewhere on the order of a couple of centimeter DEM, so a couple of centimeters per side for each pixel. But for China, the cheapest open source data was 10 meters on the side, and to get down to below a meter would have cost me $15,000 Australian, which was not something I had the money to pay for. A derived hydrology model then is not a statement, which you see on the right, is not a statement of where water actually is. It's a where water would flow if water were present. And so if you imagine, you know, the biggest rainstorm, where would water flow out of these mountains? That's what the blue shows you. So it sort of, in a sense, shows you the lowest point in any given moment, because that's where water, of course, will find itself. Each building on the georectified plan was traced in ArcGIS with a polygon assigned to its corresponding entry in the database. Walls were traced as line segments and other features denoted by icon. This allowed an immediate and effective visualization of architectural change as it was mapped. And I have to be careful about too many sidelines lest I take too much time. But just to explain for those of you who aren't familiar with GIS what that means, normally in GIS, what you might do is you put in all your data about all these little buildings in this plan, which is the map that I've georectified, and I'd use this as my so-called base map. And then if I wanted to say, show me all the buildings that were built in 1708, then GIS, ArcGIS, which is the software package, would put an asterisk or another symbol onto the buildings that were mapped in 1708. So you'd still see the entire plan, but you just get it marked with a little asterisk. And early on, I decided that what I really wanted to be able to do was create new maps. And so what I really wanted to do was get all those buildings to go away, and I'll return to that in a second. And so that's why I did this, where instead of having asterisks, each entry got its own little rectangle. And so when you said, show me all the buildings in 1708, it really showed you only the buildings that were mapped in 1708. And that was why I built this entire new map. So the product of this work, which is now known as the Bishu Shanzhuang Historical GIS, constitutes a digital surrogate of the mountain estate. Although obviously limited by the incompleteness of its data, it has the capacity to instantiate specific forms of the historical landscape that are otherwise lost to us. The data itself is highly abstracted, but when rendered visually as a map or plan, it offers a sense of the physical environment, the formation of architectural spaces, and sensory experiences of the landscape, such as view sheds and water. This is particularly so when read in, This is particularly so when read in concert with a more rhetorical or subjective of the primary sources. There is much for which it cannot account. Large absences in the archive, most significantly, but also, and crucially for the garden, certain natural features. Nonetheless, it provides the basis for broader contextualized queries into the configuration and experience of the site at different points during its history based on primary sources and through the site as a primary source, rather than on a vision of the landscape filtered through historical and historiographic lenses. Drawing together these multiple sets of concerns, understanding the palimpsestic nature of the landscape, recognizing and utilizing the overlapping nonlinear forms it takes in the available source material, and structuring research as a process capable of drawing out these issues, has necessarily compelled particular attention to methodology, particularly in terms of constructing tools and methods that are not only means to certain ends, but ways of expanding the sense of what is possible or meaningful in reconstructing this landscape. Exploring the possibilities of digital mapping and visualization, as well as their intersection with more conventional art historical methods, has been a particularly generative process. Aside from the insights into the data that such approaches are beginning to produce, of perhaps greater interest in the focus of this paper are the ways in which it has affected my thinking about the nature of historical space, the utility of spatiotemporal data, and the questions that may be asked of the past. Hold on just one second. I'm just going to, I think in the interest of time, because I think I've written too much here. So I think in the interest of time, I'm going to cut out a couple of slides and we can return to the question that I'm skipping in the Q&A so that we make sure that we have enough time for discussion. So we're going to just skip a few maps here. And we're going to go ahead to this, but we'll come back to it if you like. The mapping of temporal strata at Bishu Shanzhuang, which we've just discussed, started in an experimental and homegrown manner. Beginning with a scan of the site plan, I identified all Qianlong era buildings and, using Photoshop, simply erased them pixel by pixel. In another version, I left the buildings but highlighted them in red, which is to say, I literally went down to the pixel and anything that was black, I turned into white. And you can actually see it here because the white in the slides, these little white blobs, are where there once were buildings, and I needed to get rid of them, so I did. With a relatively low investment of time, this phase was productive for several reasons that fed directly to the more involved process of building a GIS. Not only did it offer a certain proof of concept in that it demonstrated that indeed Qianlong was responsible for the far greater portion of building at the site and therefore exploring the landscape under Kangxi offered potential insights. It also caused me to focus on each individual structure rather than looking at the plan only as a whole. And it immediately visualized for me how different the landscape and experience of it must have been under Kangxi. Of course, it also demonstrated for me the necessity of a more powerful, flexible system. In building the GIS, I became conscious of its capacity to map different versions or iterations of the landscape against one another, not just the physical site, but also ones that had only ever existed in non-topographical forms, which is a sort of rough way of saying not on the earth made of dirt. I have had trouble figuring out how to describe that when you're talking about landscapes. In doing so, I wanted to build a database that viewed text, images, and the historical landscape as commensurate. In other words, that resisted taking any particular iteration as primary or prima facie more correct, and reducing others as mere representation or reference. In some sense, the GIS prioritizes one iteration of the physical site, in that it requires a fixed location for each object to which other data can be linked. Yet its treatment of that location is essentially agnostic, in that it allows every other data point to vary and can map these relative to one another. Such a database permits the visualization of temporal strata, what we might view as the best possible reconstruction of the site at any given moment in time, as well as understanding the relationship between images, text, and geography, the nature of imagined or mnemonic landscapes, embodied or perceptual experience of space, and even historiographic questions relating to source criticism. And I want to stress here that this is a understanding of landscape that I had started to work on before I got to GIS. The idea that we can't view sites like landscapes or gardens or palaces as, or it's not perhaps ideal to view those sites as a primary landscape, the real place, and everything else is a secondary representation. Because for many people in the pre-modern world, especially when thinking about private gardens or imperial gardens, the only version of the landscape that effectively exists is the textual one or the painted one. The representation is the landscape. And that actually, even for people who visit both, who go to the garden but also get the book, their memory of the landscape is yet a third area in which the landscape takes form, informed by the other two. And so that when we situate one as primary, when we prioritize one and pretend that every other one descends from that, we lose sight of the actual ways in which human beings engage with landscape, which is really multimedia, multimodal, at various levels of physical or temporal distance removed from the actual site. What I discovered was that GIS was in a position to help me model some of those ideas, which is the idea I'm trying to convey. Of particular interest to me was the account of Zhang Yushu, who toured the garden twice in the summer of 1708 at the invitation of the emperor. Zhang's narratives are organized as itineraries, taking the reader from one site to the next, describing the scenery and recording the names and associated texts for the structures he encountered. Of course, it also serves as a terminus antiquarium for any architecture that he names. His text is detailed enough to be able to map the routes on which he was led. We see that on each occasion, his group entered by a southern gate, then proceeded down to the main lakes and out onto the central island known as Rui Island. There, they toured the island and enjoyed a banquet before boarding boats. On the first occasion, they toured the eastern side of the lakes, eventually returning via the same route by which they entered. On the second, they crossed into the foothills of the mountains to the west of the lakes, traversing those back to the entrance. Mapping these routes proved to be the critical step for a number of important insights into the design and use of the park under Kangxi that are not recorded or described in any text. The first was to observe the role of water and boat travel in Zhang's routes. Although upon initially reading the text, one might mistake boating for a mere pleasurable diversion, when looking at the map, we see in fact that there are numerous itineraries that would be substantially less convenient if not for boats. If you want to go, I can't point with a pen on my screen, you won't be able to see that. If you want to go from the theater to Wanshuyen, you either take a boat or you have to walk all the way back down and around to do that, and so on and so forth. That's sort of one of the big insights. Study of the architectural plan, the imperial poems, and the site itself led to the further identification of numerous small boat landings, some freestanding, but others incorporated directly into the architecture, indicating that boat travel was in some cases the intended mode of address for a compound. These small flat rocks appear repeatedly. This group of small flat rocks appears repeatedly in the 36 views. And you can see, as a boat landing, you can see you would just come up here in a boat, and then you would be parked right in front of the entrance hall to these two compounds. A somewhat free-form visualization of quote unquote possible boat routes resulted. This map does not rely entirely on documented boat trips. If it did so, it would greatly under-illustrate the role of water and boats in the park's design. Rather, it prioritizes the presence of possibility in the landscape, building an open-ended idea of use over a century or more of moments and occasions from the original data of two particular days in 1708. And what you've seen in the last several slides on the right are the working maps that I submitted as part of peer review for this book. And then on the left have been the finished published maps that I produced with Daniel Huffman, the cartographer I mentioned earlier. Zhang Yushu's itineraries also tell us something of the overall design conception of the park under Kangxi, particularly regarding organization of space. In his account, Zhang refers to the two itineraries on which he is led as the, quote, northeastern and northwestern scenic routes. Between them, Zhang and his fellow officials saw most of the central lakes and nearby surroundings. Notably, however, they never left that central zone, despite there being important architecture located beyond it. In some cases, Zhang refers to sites that he does not see, but that are connected to his itinerary by another path. For instance, southern mountains piled with snow, which is this pavilion you can see right here, which is accessible by a short but steep climb from the base of Cloudy Pine Gorge. So he comes up here, he stops here, he mentions this, which you could have accessed through a very steep path, but he turns south instead. When the emperor led his guests south, back along the lake, an entire new section of the park opens up to the north. A string of pavilions, compounds, and temples, and scenic sites connected by a series of trails and roads. Other examples from Zhang's account reinforce this observation. So you can see that you go up a path here, you end up at Southern Mountains piled with snow, and then you go down a little hill and you end up at this nice resting pavilion because you're really tired. And then there is another pavilion up here, northern peak nestled between two pillars. It's sitting up here at the very highest point of the garden. And then you can either descend down to a scenic waterfall and a library and another pavilion here, or you can go down and then back up to a temple, a Taoist temple, at which the emperor periodically performed rites. So there's this whole itinerary here that is sort of suggested, and Zhang knows the very beginning of, but he doesn't have any access to. He just continues south like this. By visualizing where Zhang did go, it is thus possible to understand where he did not. What emerges is an idea of a park organized in part through inner and outer, or public and private zones, areas of imperial performance for consumption by the emperor's important constituencies, and others that were for him and his intimates only, but that were nonetheless directly linked to the first by pathway, naming, and awareness. While these forms of mobility and knowledge do not necessarily appear in a garden plan, we know just as surely that they are present in the landscape for different visitors, and thus vital to regain if we are to capture a sense of how a historical landscape was intended to function. While the previous examples have shown how a non-physical landscape can speak to experience or understanding of the physical site, GIS also allows the reverse. This is particularly so for Lung Mei's monumental hanging scroll, which I have titled View of Rehe, but is sometimes called the View of the Rehe Traveling Palace, Rehe Shingong Tu, or Bishu Shanzhuang Tu, View of Bishu Shanzhuang, depending basically on when the researcher thinks it was painted. The painting has been a bit of a mystery. Untitled and undated, scholarship, presuming its highly detailed depiction of the park to be accurate, has focused on trying to determine what phase of development it captures. A map reflecting the architecture that appears in the hanging scroll juxtaposed with other Kangxi period architecture begins to address this question. We see first that Lung Mei's depiction is consistent with phase one structures constructed circa 1703 to 1708 and wholly inconsistent with phase two architecture post 1708, with one notable, if easily missed exception, the pavilion, clouds and peaks on all sides, which appears in the painting, but is believed to have constructed in 1709. And it appears in the painting up here, right on the edge, and it doesn't even appear on the map, which is how it's so easy to miss. If this dating, and that's because the map is shaped like the page of a book, and it can't therefore be wide enough, which is why we've lopped off the outer edge of the park in so many of these maps. If this dating is accurate, then the painting, or at least its preparatory work, must also date to around 1709. This is, of course, a question of relatively little utility, except in the most connoisseurial sense. What is of greater interest than what it depicts, in my opinion at least, is how it depicts it. In working on the painting, two things became almost immediately apparent. First, the use of some form of modified optical perspective reinforces the sense of first-person sight in the composition. And second, that the view thus presented departed in clear ways from topographic reality, however accurately the buildings may have been represented. Specifically, comparison with a topographical map showed that the painted valley was of a different shape than the real one. And what I want to point out there is the shape that surrounds the gardens, the lakes, is a fairly narrow V, yeah? And here you can see that the lakes are actually on one side of a fairly round valley. this area that's mostly open is the valley, right? And so there's a real difference in shape between the painting and topographic reality. Although there are were pictorial and symbolic possibilities to account for this, I began to wonder if there was also a physical one. This question was made more pressing by the realization made standing on Rui Island, this big island right here, during fieldwork, that there is a pavilion located in the mountains several kilometers to the south of the park from which one could clearly see most or all of the site. And here, the mountains I'm talking about are here. So this is the Wulia River Valley that continues here. And then the mountains come in as the river turns right there. Yeah. Contrary to conventional wisdom about Chinese landscape painting, which holds that compositions were the work of the studio and the artist's memory or imagination, could Lung Mei's painting record an actual real world view of Bishu Shanzhuang? I began to test this theory using viewshed analysis, selecting view points essentially by trial and error. And for those of you who don't know, viewshed analysis is a type of geographic analysis in which using the DEM, that 2.5D, 3D model of the territory that I spoke about a couple of minutes ago, you choose a point on a point in the real world, and it shows you everything that is or is not visible from that point, so it shows you what you can see or the view shed from that particular point. And you can do all sorts of cool things like raise that point to 186 centimeters because I'm 186 centimeters tall. And so I can see how much I can see from my height, which is a bit more, not surprisingly, than I can from lying on the ground, stuff like that. This quickly proved the proposition possible. As it demonstrated, and this is a very, very early DEM, very nice rough DEM, as it demonstrated that the southern mountains where the pavilion stands, marked by this bright green dot here, are low enough, are low and distant enough that an intervening ridge, which is to say this red thing, what you see in red here, or what is this mark here, that this ridge extending across the valley from the east obscures the area of the floodplain behind it, which is to say, as you see here in red, which is the color that you can't see, this ridge is high enough that you can't see this whole area when you're standing down here in the south. I was unable to pinpoint a convincing location for the viewpoint until I realized that in the painting, a line extended from the approximate vanishing point of the valley, marked here by this red line and this mountain right here, the approximate vanishing point of the valley back towards the picture plane precisely intersects three buildings, and that moreover, those buildings are also precisely aligned in reality. So the point is that going from the from the vanishing point up here, one building, two building, three building really are perfectly lined up in a straight line, and they are shown as perfectly lined up in a straight line in 1, 2, 3 in the painting as well. And that moreover, extended south, this line remarkably connected exactly to the viewing pavilion that I had noticed in the park. And thus my random selection of viewpoints here, which I had tried a number of years before, became a single really obvious viewpoint, a pavilion that is still extant and is located here and labeled as the southern viewpoint. Projecting viewshed specifically from the pavilion confirmed the initial thesis in that it helped account for the essentially straight eastern edge of Lung Mei's valley and also explains the representation of the mountain ridges. And what I mean there is that you can see here that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 ridges that you can are visible from the southern viewpoint marked in gray here, and that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 ridges that are visible. But then if we mark out approximately the picture plane of the picture, you can see stuff that's outside of the picture from the viewpoint, but the painting itself is roughly this. Then what you see is only this ridge in the foreground, and then 2, 3, 4, which if we go back really quickly, is this ridge in the foreground, and then 2, 3, 4. So you see exactly what you see in the painting. You see once you've sort of marked out the thing. Forgive me. Yet the viewshed also raised new questions. Why, for instance, is it possible to see certain buildings and features in the painting, such as the central and the southern end of the Central Lakes, that are clearly hidden from view in the viewshed analysis? You can't see this area down here, but you can see it so clearly in the painting. An answer is suggested by the practical realities of how Lung Mei or an assistant might have recorded the site in the first place. Trigonometric surveying was, by the early 18th century, well understood and in wide practice in the Kangxi court. Such surveying requires a second viewpoint from which to triangulate position, one suggested in this case by the angle at which the central buildings are represented in Lung Mei's painting. Again, working backwards from the architecture of the surrounding hills, the intervening ridge that blocked Lung Mei's view from the south appears to provide the ideal second vantage from the southeast. Here, GIS enabled the testing and demonstration of hypotheses that emerge from close looking at both the painting and the landscape. This process has not provided a definitive explanation for exactly how Lung Mei created his painting, but it has demonstrated the underlying principles with a strong degree of certainty. Like many of the questions that emerge from mapping Zhang Yishu's tours, GIS can be made, in this case, to map the embodied and perceptual experience of space, specifically both visibility and vision. The results constitute another form of sight, a variant view that can be understood as another iteration of the landscape. It also represents a new approach to engaging formally with the image, and as such is an example of how mapping and visualization, broadly construed, may be used by historians of art, architecture, and landscape to recover obscured forms and understandings in the objects of their study. In many respects, this project runs counter to what digital humanities supposedly is or has become. It is decidedly not so-called big data, though it is certainly more than I would have been able to keep in my head or reasonably work out on paper, as is demonstrated by those early experiments in which I erased pixels. It is also not particularly reflective of distant looking or a synoptic view, either within the site or across multiple sites or geographies. In fact, quite the opposite. When I first set out to build the database, I had not yet learned to use ArcGIS, and so began by attempting to build the geospatial data by hand and on foot. Using a handheld GPS and a digital camera, I approached each building, photographing the accessible facades and recording lat long for several points on each structure. Ultimately, this data proved not particularly useful, and I scarcely made direct use of it. Nevertheless, the data collection process itself proved vital for a variety of unexpected reasons that are intimately connected to understanding the building of a database as a generative form of research akin not only to writing, in that it is a process of knowledge organization comparable to written scholarship, but also to close looking, as practiced by so many art historians. Interested in creating as complete and accurate a record of GPS locations as possible, the discipline of geotagging compelled me to walk up to every building, foundation, or ruin I could find, several hundred individual structures in total. Thinking about how individual buildings fit within larger complexes, how complexes related to one another, identifying the location of lost structures, and gaining an intimate connection to the landscape itself as I walked over and through it, fundamentally changed not only how well, but how I understood the mountain estate. The same may be said of the database that has since been constructed. The need to assign a number and name or description to each structure has forced me to engage at a granular level with a large and highly complex design landscape in a way that other forms of research could not. I see this engagement with the landscape as a process akin to close looking as practiced by many art historians. Sustained, focused examination that leads not to pulling back, but to burrowing in, a process through which an image opens up to its viewer. While the buildings themselves may not require this kind of close examination, they are, for the most part, not unusual architecturally, and the overlapping instances of decay and restoration mean that we are no longer seeing anything that is remotely so-called original. The landscape as a whole does. This is a process that can ultimately only be done through careful traversing and focused looking, through struggling with identifying exactly what you are looking at, learning an archive just like any other archive, except that this one is outdoors. This form of close looking also works with the GIS to explore issues that traverse scale. It is possible to explore the site at multiple levels, building, valley, park, even region, while putting each in conversation with the others. This tension is analogous to other forms of dialogue described above, most particularly between the multiple iterations of the landscape. By holding each of these scales present simultaneously, we are able to understand the mountain estate not as a single art historical object, but as multiple objects that can be studied in concert with one another, just as the site would have been understood by its visitors. There is a final reason to favor this form of close reading that focuses on the production and experience of space, as opposed to what could be identified as more distant questions relating to typology, orientation, grouping, or other structural features of the architectural system. Distant reading has been critiqued for its failure to address questions of gender, sexuality, or race. That the distance of distance reading has favored the tracking of familiar, dominant narratives at the expense of work uncovering long neglected or hidden ones. It is not that these distant questions do not ultimately yield valuable insights into architecture, Chinese architecture, or that we should necessarily abandon them. Rather, it is that Chinese architectural studies, in my opinion, have too often failed to look past structure and typology in particular, such that description and classification seem to replace the possibility of analysis or interpretation, or are put in reflective service of an uncritical notion of cultural or national Chineseness. This in turn leads to a minimization of change over time, a sense of timelessness that art historian Craig Clunas and others have rightly identified as a form of Orientalist projection. By contrast, I hope that the close looking and explorative process described today burrows beyond static configurations in an effort to activate a specific space, by which I mean space that is historically, temporally, and narratively particular. Once described, such specific spaces may begin to connect horizontally and vertically to other spaces and to larger historical questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen, for this very rich and inspiring lecture. I'm still in awe thinking about how to make sense of everything from the historical materials to the technology that you have introduced to us. So I have a question. So in the meantime, I think the audience may also have some question in mind. So everybody is welcome to type your question in the chat box. My question is that you mentioned a concept, spatial archive, which I think is very intriguing and also very important as well. So in order to reconstruct the sense of space, whether it's historical, the historical sense of space of Bishu Shanzhuang in his own time, you know, Kangxi time, and to explore that kind of spatial topography and also the perceptions of space as represented by text and visual material. So I was wondering what kind of prerequisites, you know, are needed if scholars are also interested in following your model, you know, to reconstruct or to locate the spatial archive and to figure out the relationship between space and representations of location, you know, in different cultural forms.
What sort of sources are needed for that work?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think that the hope was that, let me think about how to answer it. Okay. So the hope was that, especially in a relatively source scarce environment, the Kangxi court, which is a source for a context in which there are relatively few comparatively few surviving archival records. The idea, of course, was to try to extract as much information as possible from as many different things as possible. So in some sense, the other way to thing to say was, if I don't have, let's suppose I'm doing Bishu Shanzhuang under Qianlong, there are a lot more sources, but I still need to identify all the little details about this building or that building, about this bridge or that bridge, and organize them in some fashion. And so what the GIS does for me, but any database could do for anybody, is figure out a system of organization by which you would collect and sort all that information. You would say, okay, so I have a series of records that say that this bridge was built in this year, that once in this other year it was crossed by the emperor, then another time it burned down and was reconstructed, and then they, you know, someone sailed under it by a boat. And then you sort of you organize, and all those things are different. They're events that happen, they're connected with time and space. It was repainted red, then it was repainted yellow. I don't know, whatever it is. It gives you a way of organizing all of those little fragmentary pieces that often appear in very random places, you know, in the Qijuzhu, where you're not looking for architectural data, but it happens to say they cross this bridge. Okay, now I've garnered that fact. How do I make sure, how do I begin to collect all these random pieces of information and figure out what I can say about this complex architectural space? Because on its own, I might not pay any attention to that architectural fact, but in collection with a whole lot of other details that are similarly random or obscure, I can start to create a picture of, say, usage of the site, or, you know, Zhang Yushu gets to go here, but the emperor gets to go there, or whatever it is. The other important thing is to say that, you know, I think that collecting information from images was also really important, because among other things, even before I got to the sort of relatively complete state of the finished product, the first question I really needed to satisfy myself was, if I'm looking at all these images of Bishu Shanzhuang from the Kangxi period, and in fact, in some ways, the most images of Bishu Shanzhuang exist from the Kangxi period, which is the period of time in which the fewest documents exist. So there's a sort of inverse of our normal archival work. The first thing I had to decide was and figure out was, do they actually tell me anything? Do they record the site in any accurate way? Or are they, you know, 50% real and 50% fictional? Does you know, the building that's at the center of a given picture, is it really 4 bays wide? Does it really have a patio in front? Or is that just a sort of fantasy? The building that's pictured off in the side that is not the focus of this project, is that just put there for compositional reasons? Or is that a real building that bears some relationship to the building that's depicted? That sort of images had to be tested in that way before I could understand how and if I could use them. So all of those things were helped by the construction of the GIS. I hope that makes sense and answers your question.
Yeah, thank you for giving me these very comprehensive questions of how information's are organized with the help of GIS. So I have a follow-up question, and after that I will turn the time to Lu. So now we have all of this archival materials, although it's not a lot according to you, and we also have a technology like GIS, so to reconstruct the original topography of Bishu Shanzhuang. So I was wondering, for LeMay's time, as you have shown, his painting somehow the sense of space also quite scientifically accurate in a specific way. So is there any information can tell us how he what kind of information or what kind of methods help him creating this kind of painting, which you have described in your book that the sense of space is also pretty modern in this time? And it's, the perspective is imagined, you know, it's elevated. So I think that's a question I have.
So my understanding, and I see that Professor Thomas from HKU is here, so he may be able to chime in and tell me if I'm wrong about this. The basic answer to that question is the way in which, particularly the elevated perspective, right? That although it shows the record space as though seen from the ground, observed from the ground. So the way that was done was through some sort of trigonometric surveying, right? They figured out where particularly the buildings were and they mapped them out. And the transference of surveyed data about a essentially flat space, like a city observed from a height. And then the process of taking that mathematical data and transforming it into a pictorial map, of which Longmei, I argue in my book, but also Longmei is sort of fairly easily seen, as we could describe it as a picture map of sort. that process was by 1708 very well understood and several centuries old in Europe, and now well understood in China. That was a process that was developed, among others, by Leon Battista Alberti in mapping of Rome in the late 15th century, and doesn't require even that the surveyor and the painter be the same person. The data is translatable by another person. So Kathy, you could go survey Bishu Shanzhuang, and if I knew how to do it, I could transform that into a picture map of Bishu Shanzhuang. How exactly that's done, I'm not sure we entirely understand. But the piece that I know that we don't entirely understand, but the people are trying to figure out, is then how do we shoot it up in the air, right? How do we then transform that data into a bird's eye perspective? What I have argued in a recent article that was published earlier in the summer that didn't make it in time for this book, but that was published earlier in the summer in Art Bulletin, is that the point of view, the bird's eye point of view, so-called, that the painting captures can actually be fixed pretty precisely to a certain point, if memory serves, about 300 meters above the ground and about halfway between the mountain estate and the mountains to the south, though maybe I've gotten the exact location of that wrong, I don't remember. And that is a technique, a sort of bird's eye projection of data that was, of course, gathered on the ground because people can't fly at that point. You know, that sort of bird's eye projection is something that we see in a variety of early modern European city plans, particularly famously in Venice. There are a number, but other cities as well. And again, perhaps Professor Thomas can correct me. My understanding is that European art historians or map cartographic historians don't fully understand how this was done yet. And certainly I don't claim to understand. What I only claim to have demonstrated, at least to my satisfaction, is that this is true of Lung Mei's painting. That Lung Mei did employ, either by himself or with the assistance of other people like his teacher Jia Bingzhen or Europeans in the court, did employ techniques that allowed this type of projection to be created. And that this painting is a reflection of that type of projection. It's not just a, let me gather an imagined view of this place and then paint it.
All right, great. Thank you. A question for future art historian to explore more.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Right. All right, Lou.
Oh, okay, Stephen, thank you very much. I mean, this use of this new tools, GIS, and to actually build an archive and database and the map, and even a knowledge structure by yourself is very fascinating for me. And I think your talk basically also focuses on this methodology. So my question would be a little bit maybe on something maybe more symbolic. You talk about how you collect or try to document all these information. So I'm wondering, because I was reading the introduction of the book, and I was drawn to a line here when you say landscape is a kind of it's kind of an intertextual thing. You also mentioned that the landscape is not a physical space per se, but a combination of memory and also painting, text and everything, right? And so you also say in that case, landscape is not only a reflection of a certain ideological expression or even the emperor himself or the power of the emperor, but also an active medium of that. So my question would maybe, shift from the methodology to this dimension of meaning, or how do you think about, for example, this perspective of viewing or painting or creating this idea of landscape of Bishu Shanzhuang, maybe illustrate this power making or this kind of value making process.
Sure. Well, you know, I mean, it's a really interesting question and one I'm trying to sort of grapple with how to answer succinctly. Early on in this project, I remember thinking about Bishu Shanzhuang as the model home of the empire. And by that I meant, like, you know, when in a new real estate development, they create one home and that's what they take you on a tour on. And it's the one that looks exactly like it's supposed to be with all the perfect furniture and the paint, blah, 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 right? Bishu Shanzhuang, in my view, in my interpretation, didn't represent, at least under Kangxi, and it changes under Qianlong, and this is why it's so important to separate, for me, Kangxi and Qianlong at this site. Under Kangxi, Bishu Shanzhuang instantiates it doesn't just represent an empire as it is, it instantiates an empire as Kangxi is aspiring for it to be. It is a site that joins Ne and Y, you know, inner and outer, that brings those things together, that that represents new imaginations of the Qing as opposed to pre-existing geographic formations. And so while it's not a particularly, while it's easy enough to say, and others have said, that Bishu Shanzhuang is the empire in miniature, I think it's equally important to say in Kangxi, it was an active part of the creation of the imagination of that empire in miniature. Right? That empire that hadn't yet fully been, it's only right by this 1690s that the final wars of conquest are finished, that the final treaties with the Mongols finished. And within 5 years, he's building Bishu Shanzhuang. Now that's partially because ending war has made it possible for him to spend more time traveling and hunting and doing other things. It's made it more comfortable for officials to allow him out of the capital from a security perspective and various other things like that. But it also is because he moves from sort of hard power, military campaigns, to what we would call soft power, examinations, scholarly sponsorship, and the building of gardens that he can then use to host people at. And so I really wanted to sort of suggest that it wasn't just that a garden or a painting or whatever is a sort of static representation of this fully formed identity or emperorship or whatever, but that it's an active part of the imagination, the creation, the bringing this identity into being. That it is part of the process, just like writing a book is part of the process of getting to the book, right? That you got to paint the painting to achieve the thing that the painting seeks to imagine. And that's probably not true of every garden out there, or even every imperial garden, but I think that it is an important way of understanding the relationship between gardens and identity in general in China, in the sense that, like, gardens, even private gardens, are, like, maybe especially private gardens, if you think about the sort of famous examples of sort of autobiography through garden, like Qi Biaojia, who writes extensively about, like, his own process of self-discovery and of becoming through the process of building his garden. That seems to be a really important theme to build, for me at least, to draw out.
Thank you very much. Just one quick follow-up, because I'm thinking that this Bishu Shanzhuang is not really accessible to many people. It's quite right. Exclusive. So if there's like a limited audience or visitors or people who could have this access to see this garden, so among whom this identity is being built?
Well, I think that's a super important question. And on the one hand, so it's from a practical perspective, from the perspective of the physical site, the answer to that question is fairly straightforward. In addition to certain elite court officials, the rule Mongol and Manchu or Jurchen leaders are invited every summer They lie to, they come to court every summer, they give gifts, they do various other things. And also officials and from around the leading officials, like governors and other people from around the inner empire, from, you know, Ming territories, basically. And indeed, a point that I make sort of very much in passing in the book is that this is another way that the empire is sort of imagined as a whole, is that periodically he holds banquets, Kangxi holds banquets at Bishu, Shanzhuang, in which every province and every Mongol group and every Jurchen group is represented. And so the empire sort of comes together at these banquets and forms a Qing whole rather than a Guanne and Guanwai divide, yeah? But then I think that's also why it's really important, especially in this case, you know, not so much in Tiger Hill or in Westlake that are essentially public places. So if you live close enough or travel there, you can see it. Maybe there are elite places, but still they're basically public. But the books, the 36 Views books, they are the whole of, they are the entirety of the experience of Bishu Shanzhuang for many of its recipients. They weren't hugely distributed. There were only 400 copies made under Kangxi. But and Qianlong then makes another edition in the 1740s. In which he adds matching poems. But it's not like in Kangxi's age, there were thousands of these and they were public knowledge and they were sold at, you know, in booksellers in Beijing. No, not at all. But nevertheless, that's a beginning of a sort of a trickling out of knowledge. But it's important then to take that as a distinctive form of the landscape, because that is the form in which it exists for many people. And it's just as real in that sense as the real site is for other people. One could say.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think that's a very important question. But since time is running out, let's maybe turn our time to the Q&A, because there are a few questions typed there already. So the first one is by Professor Greg Thomas of Hong Kong U. The question is, did you find any changes in water levels over time? And did you uncover any new evidence of dams, slugs, or other manipulations of water?
Thank you for that question. The answer to that is yes, though not perhaps as scientifically as I would have liked, given more time and different focus. There is a particularly great memorial, a very, very long memorial that is extant and published that doesn't describe precisely the water system, but describes its failings. All the different sluice gates and dams and channels that get gummed up with silt over the course of the year. And basically, particularly say, we'd really, really like to clean this out, but you come so early in the spring and you leave so late in the winter that they're frozen all the time. And so we really need you to not come so soon so that they thaw and then we can clean out the water system. So it's a really interesting example of, you know, where the historic document tells you about how the system fails, but doesn't actually describe the system in great detail. There are other examples. There is extant evidence of faced stone water channels in various places in the mountain to channel the water, obviously. It's difficult to say, of course, when those date from. But then if you look in the 36 views, there are a number of images, particularly in the mountain section, that have water flowing through or incorporate water in the scenery of the architecture, which of course would have had to be flowing water that came in and out. My research, so then the last thing I found, first of all, there is no river, at least extant, in the mountains. There is no great water source that would have kept a constant waterfall going up there. And I did discover evidence of giant cisterns near the tops of the mountains, including one that was positioned extremely closely to a viewing pavilion that in the 36 views incorporates water in its flow. What that suggests to me is that there were holding tanks and that the scenery that involved water was actually artificial and triggered by controlled releases. So the emperor said, I'm going to go up to the viewing pavilion today. They said, right, see you there. And shortly after he arrived, you know, they pull it out and they cause a flow. And then for however long it lasts, that flow lasts. And architecture is built in several stages along the same series flow. There are several of them through the mountains, suggesting that therefore one controlled release activates the waterborne scenery of several places. It is, of course, possible that we've lost track of that water that was once there is lost. I don't know. And I'm sure that there are archaeologists who could answer that question. That's not a question with any great certainty that I can answer. Shall we move on to the next question?
All right. Yeah, sure. So Lu, do you want to read that question out?
Sure. The second question is about the Chineseness that is created in Bishu Shanzhuang by the architecture complex in Rehe. So if there was such Chineseness, how was it constructed? And could you please illustrate this a little bit by giving maybe an example?
Yeah. So I'm under Kangxi, was there a particular Chineseness? Certainly there were evocations of Chinese. If what we're describing as Chinese here is essentially Ming or Guanne culture and space, then certainly the Central Lakes were understood quite explicitly and imagined quite explicitly as intending to evoke West Lake, which is a place that both Kangxi and Qianlong greatly liked. And certainly there are examples of architecture that evoke specific sort of elements of Han culture. Particularly, there is a Qishui pavilion, a pavilion for floating cups to recreate Wang Xizhe and the Lanting Shu. So there is one of those. Beyond that, was there a particular sense of Chineseness? I think it's really hard to understand, in part because I think it's difficult to parse what is Chinese and not under the Qing. I mean, I find for me that ethnic identification is in some ways quite explicit. You know, under Qianlong, he's very anxious about Manchu identity and the fading of Manchu identity, and he defines that very explicitly: language, archery, horseback riding. But it's a little bit less clear and a little less explicit what represents the performance of something that is intentionally Chinese and what is more a reflection of Chinese aspects, perhaps, of a more syncretic Qing culture. So yes, there are certainly references to Chinese spaces, and those only increase under Qianlong as he starts to quote more and more Chinese gardens. But there are also lots of references to inner Asian, to Manchu, Tibet, Mongol spaces and landscapes.
Okay, so good. There's another question by Arena. It's kind of relevant. Her short question is there anything Manchu?
Mine is Manchu.
About the site, yes.
So is there anything that's defined explicitly as Manchu? Certainly Kangxi hosted Manchus and Mongols at the site quite a bit. And they did, though disappointingly little is recorded about what those events involved. They did involve day trips, I assume basically day trips for hunting. I think there was even hunting some inside the park. I think that the park was probably stocked with deer so that they could be hunted. There were archery contests, riding contests, military demonstrations, various things that would have highlighted Manchu forms of performative identity. So in that sense, it's a sort of use of the park rather than a architectural element. There are also evidence of, though the specific date of these is difficult to determine, there are ways in which the architecture is certainly characteristic of what we think of now as Northeastern architecture. Specifically, the end walls were made of brick, while the rest was wood in a way that is characteristic of Northern architecture. And there also is a very clever system of sort of underfloor heating, which is not something I realized that you really need in Hong Kong. But in Shenyang, we see evidence, which is the pre-Qing capital of China, or excuse me, of China, of the Manchus. There is evidence that whole buildings had their floors heated by fires that were kept by flue systems, and they would create a fire in a fireplace or in a furnace outside the building, and then the hot air would go under the entire floor and heat the floor. And we see the same thing in Bishu, Shanzhuang. Now, someone here may tell me, oh, mate, that's not Manchu, that's Chinese. In which case, I take it back. It's not Manchu. I honestly don't know. It's something that I've only ever seen at Bishu, Shanzhuang and at Shenyang, and that I think is interesting. There are probably other good examples that on the spot I'm not coming up with. But I think that more than anything, the important thing to understand is that Rehe was part of a constellation of traveling palaces. It was the largest, most important, but it was a part of a sort of whole network of traveling palaces that linked Beijing to Mulan, the imperial hunting grounds. And that all of those travel palaces were located in or near the sort of central sites of important Mongol allies. And so they, so the idea was that by moving from traveling palace to traveling palace, the emperor was not calling people to court, but actually going to pay call upon important Mongol allies. And that was a really, really big part of how he maintained these alliances over the course of the hunting season and over the summer, was traveling around and seeing people, hosting them on hunts, giving them banquets, et cetera, et cetera. And so in that way, Bishu Shanzhuang is intimately related to the practice of a sort of Manchu-Mongol inter-Asian kingship by both Kangxi and Qing.
Okay, I think we have time only for the very last, but also long question. But I think this question is about how the paintings could possibly in a reverse way to influence the construction of landscape infrastructure and architecture in Rehe. So while your talk is basically talk about how LeMay's painting represents the built landscape. So for example, some later built architectures, did they command ideal views or visions from LeMay's paintings?
Well, not specific. It's a super, super interesting question and one that I have to think more about. It is not from Longmei's painting, in the sense that Longmei's painting, the only view that is commanded from Longmei's painting is this completely impossible view of 300 meters up in the air. And are there, for the most part, I think that it is important to see, one of the insights of the GIS was that later development or even contemporary development of architecture was intended to take advantage of certain views and view areas, view sheds, really, right? Like I can see this whole new area from this place, I'll construct a building here. And indeed, one of the things that I think is possible, may not be work that I ever do, but I think that we could begin to reconstruct the forestry plan of earlier Bishu Shanzhuang by saying this building was designed to take advantage of this view. That means we need to clear these trees out to reimagine how the place was originally forested. Because lots of views that once did exist are now blocked by the forest. I don't know of any example that that does what you're talking about, Panya, in exactly the reverse. A painted design of the site that imagined a view that then was built later on. No, I don't know. And I did briefly wonder, not briefly, for a while, I really thought about, is it possible that we ought to put Longmei's painting at 1703? That Longmei's painting imagines a garden that was essentially a plan for the garden that was later built. And in the end, I just concluded that there was no evidence that supported that. I mean, in theory, is it possible? Would I be blown away if someone proved that? No, I'd just be super excited. Because ultimately what we don't have is any plan of how the place was constructed. And it's not conceivable that paintings that paintings and models that the emperor requested in 1702 and 1703, that those weren't at one point made. You couldn't build this place from your mind. And so, you know, completely from your imagination. So I wish that we did have that, but I'm afraid I can't cite a good example.